Hello, everybody. If you're knocked up, have a girlfriend that's knocked up, or planning on having a baby and want to know all about home birth, stay tuned. You're going to be a smarty pants at the next baby shower. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us with This Week in Health and Wellness. I'm Julie C. May, and our show is brought to you by the Girls of Healthy Bitch Daily, the popular daily website and email. Today, I have Amanda Coulong with me. I'm sure you might have seen her on This Week in Network. She's joining with me today to talk about home births, something I don't have a personal...
I don't have any personal experience
no
with
personal
it yet
experience,
either, but it's definitely something I think we should explore.
It is, and I think what's really important about today's show is that we're not here, or anyone's not here, to push the agenda down anyone's throat. It's about to really talk about choice. Mm-hmm. And just to have all your information, if you're choosing to have a baby at home or in a hospital, what the deal is.
Right. I mean, I feel like most women, I would say a lot of women that I know that have had children weren't aware that they could actually have a home-based birth.
I would agree with
that. And they weren't given those options. And some of my friends have even said after the fact, wow, I didn't realize there were so many options locally where I could have my baby at home or in a birthing center.
Yeah.
So.
And there's a lot of documentaries out and books that mm-hmm. have been coming out in the recent years. Ricky Lake is
a huge proponent
of this. You know, I've been watching her on different TV shows, and her whole message is it's about choice. She's mm-hmm. not, you know, saying you're a bad person if you have, you know, this in a hospital.
Yeah.
But I think we're going to play a trailer to a documentary. It's called The Business of Birth. I believe it's not Business of Being Born. Sorry. We're going to play the trailer.
Yeah, let's run.
They want those beds filled and emptied. They don't want women hanging around in the labor room.
Technology is technology. It's not stopping. So if you're going to have good stuff, you might as well use it to get the best outcome.
Maternity care in the United States is in crisis.
People don't have the information.
Medical decisions are being made for monetary and legal reasons, not because they're good for the mother and the baby.
This is Pitocin, which is the medication given through the IV that causes contractions.
Just check that she's on PIT.
Just make sure that she's on PIT.
I asked to keep upping the PIT.
And if you're uncomfortable, we can always give you more.
Is this an improvement, or are we making things worse?
How often do you get to see a fully natural birth?
Rarely.
Almost never.
Everywhere else in the world, you see midwives attending 70 or 80% of all the births, and the United States stands alone.
You want to talk big lobby, big dollars, they can kind of call a lot of shots.
Accusations tonight that some hospitals are not being upfront with patients who are expecting a baby.
Cesarean is extremely doctor-friendly. It's 20 minutes, and I'll be home for dinner.
Basically, what the medical profession has done is convince the vast majority of women that they don't know how to birth.
If I could do that, I could do anything. To me, that's the power of birthing, and that is what we are taking away from women.
It wasn't an illness. It wasn't something that needed to be numbed. It needed to be experienced.
It was the most adventurous day I've ever had in my life.
I don't even have a diaper. I don't even have a bassinet.
I have to get there. I cannot have another contraction in this taxi cab.
Switch on a light switch and you go to the moon.
This is what I was after. This is what I wanted for my child.
Nothing compares to the privilege of giving life and the responsibility of that. Nothing.
Oh my God! 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 Hi! Hi! Oh my God! Hi!
We had a baby!
You sure did.
You know, in the in the documentary, Ricky Lake shows her baby being born.
Wow.
Hoo-hoo-ha.
Yeah. The whole shebang.
The whole shebang. That's really gutsy.
It is.
But way to drive a point home, right?
I know.
I mean, if you to share that moment with millions of people.
She clearly cares about home-based birth.
Clearly. I'm a little too prude to be able to do something like that. But, you know, I think it's, and we're going to talk about this later on the show, we have a midwife, a licensed midwife, and we also have somebody who she helped give birth to two children.
Wow.
This woman's two, we're going to have her later in the show, both of them. But, you know, realistically, I think one of the things we talk about when we talk about home birth is, like, the pain.
Oh,
yeah. Like, what are you, nuts? No drugs?
Yeah.
And, you know, I found a video that I wanted to show because we want to be realistic that without an epidural, it doesn't look like a walk in the park.
I don't think it ever is a walk in the park.
No.
But it is interesting to actually see how painful it can be.
Let's watch this clip.
Get down on the baby.
Oh, God. Am I opening? Yes. Is it coming?
Yeah, push. Oh,
push. Push. Come on, baby.
Big
come
breath
on.
And push. That's all right.
Oh my God.
I don't know about you, but my legs got
that was the
closed
best
a little tighter.
That was the best form of birth control ever.
Yeah, I'm done. Not happening. Well,
but it's real.
It
you
is
know,
real.
It's real, and it's obviously very painful. And I think some women are probably scared about, well, if I do it at home and I decide that, you know, it's too much, what do? I'm stuck.
Exactly.
So there are a lot of questions like that are around home-based birth, and people are worried about
well,
it.
Well, I watched another video, which we're not going to show, but basically a woman had two cesareans.
Ooh.
And then on her third baby, she wanted to have it at home. And she had it taped from start to finish her whole journey.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows that she had cesarean one baby. They did not bring the baby to her till 4 hours after the fact.
Wow.
And she had this kind of lifeless look on her face. She was drugged. Yeah. She was holding her baby. Baby number two, similar situation. Baby number three had it at home in the bathtub, in that, like, the tub they
right.
bring. And she has this angelic moment on her face. Mm-hmm. She has her baby right away, and they're crying. I'm crying. I'm all emotional.
Yeah.
But I think there's a beautiful story to be told. When you do it at home, it's a different, perhaps, connection.
Well, and I think we saw that with the Business of Being Born video. I mean, it's such a precious moment, and it is, it's a very powerful moment for a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And for her to have that choice and to be able to do it in a way that makes sense for her. And if you think about it, I mean, that baby's been in her stomach for 9 months, and to just rip it away from her as soon as it comes out.
And to wait 4 hours.
And to wait that long. I mean, is that really necessary? Those are the sorts of questions I'm really curious about.
And we're going to get those answered shortly. But first, we are going to watch a video that's been played 4.1 million times on YouTube.
Yeah.
This is Olivia's story.
With my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands.
With my own, with my own two hands. I can hold you in my own two hands, and I can comfort you with my own two hands.
But you got to use your own two hands. Use your own, use your own two hands.
Use your own, use your own two hands. With our own, with our own two hands.
With our own.
I think all of our ovaries are tugging a little right
that
now.
That was so beautiful.
It was beautiful.
I mean, it just shows that it's an experience that the whole family can take part in, and that it's appropriate, it's okay to have your other children there, to mm-hmm. have, you know, your mother, your father, whoever you need, to have them there with you, supporting you.
I think it's a big contrast to the stereotypical Hollywood where, you know, the dad's in there and he passes out within seconds of seeing, you know, the
mom-to-be is whisked away. I mean, you know, it's so different.
Well, we have in studio today two very special guests. We have a licensed midwife, and it's brand new here in Los Angeles, the Sanctuary Birth and Wellness Center. Her name is Aleksandra Evanguelidi. Okay, I think I got it right. And Sarah Rosenhaus, who is one of her clients, I guess. I don't know if you'd call her clients, but a mother who had two children, and Alex was there to be part of the birth and was her midwife. So I want to thank you guys for joining us. We have a bunch of questions to shoot at you guys.
Great.
So we're going to start with you, Alex. Just tell us really quickly about who's like a candidate for home birth? Is there some sort of criteria when you're meeting with potential new mothers that might be at the sanctuary to have a home birth with you, mm-hmm. or have it at their home, rather? What do you kind of screen? What are the questions?
Well, you know, we deal with low-risk pregnancy, so typically we're dealing with healthy women. We're also dealing with the type of person that takes responsibility for their well-being. So, you know, women who exercise, eat well, women who have no high-risk conditions, like heart problems, mm-hmm. seizure issues. Sometimes asthma can be an issue, or severe diabetes. You know, there's certainly... it's women who are healthy to begin with, okay. And we don't look at age as an indicator of risk.
Oh, so, okay, that's interesting. Yeah.
Sometimes typical doctors will be like, well, 35, you're high risk. And we don't see that to be the case.
But the number one high risk thing is?
It's not one thing.
It's not one thing, okay.
But there's factors, and we screen our clients when they come to us, and certainly would let them know if they are a good candidate or not for a home birth or birth center birth.
Got it. Okay.
Then we also have Sarah joining us, too. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, Sarah, what was the process you went through to find Alex and to decide that you wanted to have a home-based birth?
It's interesting, actually, because I have my two youngest siblings were born at home. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so when I got pregnant, I didn't go to a midwife. I went to an OB.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Yeah, surprisingly. And I'd always thought I would probably have a home birth, but when the time came, I asked my gynecologist, who should I see? And he gave me the name of an OB, and I went, and I started seeing an OB who was actually a very conservative OB. And I never connected with her. And when I was about 32 weeks pregnant, my son had not turned. He was still sitting breech, kind of with his tushy down and his body kind of sideways across in my belly. And the OB at 32 weeks, I still had 8 weeks to go, started talking to me about scheduling my C-section.
Wow.
And I flipped out and got really upset. And I had a doula, who's a birth coach, who I was seeing. And we started talking about alternative solutions. And I brought up that I'd had siblings born at home. And she said, well, there's this amazing midwife in Los Angeles, and you should talk to them. And so I called Alex, and we talked. And I went in, and I met with her, and basically decided at about 33 weeks that I was going to have a home birth instead of a hospital birth.
And what were people's reactions, family and friends, when you told them, I'm going to drop this baby on my living room floor, essentially, right?
In a tub.
Well, my dad and my stepmom, who had had home births, were ecstatic, and they were kind of like, we were wondering what took you so long. And everybody else was like, oh, no, what are you doing? You know, and I just basically said, this is what I need to do. And I had been reading quite a bit about home birth, and just, you know, the minute I met Alex and we connected, and, you know, it was just such a different space than this kind of medical doctor spending 15 minutes not answering my questions, not giving me any kind of nurturing for an experience that is probably one of the most incredible and powerful experiences that you're going to go through in your life. And you kind of want a partner, not a clinical, you know, experience.
Did you scream like that woman we saw that scared the crap out of us?
Both times.
Well, on a scale of 1 to 10, what was your pain ratio?
You know what? A lot of it was in my head. The pain...
I would beg to differ. It's not in your head, but that's okay.
No, it hurts. But I remember just 3 months ago when my son was born, I remember screaming to Alex, I'm terrified, I'm terrified, I'm so scared to do this. And it wasn't even, I was pushing, and it wasn't hurting that much. But there was this anticipation of when his head was going to start, you know, coming through, what's it going to be like, and how is that going to feel?
We have some photos while we're talking of just your family, your partner Michael, and your two children. Again, you just mentioned you gave birth three months ago.
3 months ago.
Look at that.
And that's Matthew, and the baby is
Reese. That's my older son, Matthew.
Oh, and both adorable. were born at home.
At home. And
you look quite normal to me.
And those babies
look healthy. You don't look like a she doesn't look like a freak or anything.
No.
She's a normal girl. Look at those eyes. He's like a Gerber baby.
My boy.
Look, they're normal.
We're normal
they
people.
They read books, too.
Yeah,
look,
I know. It's amazing.
Amazing.
Yep.
And that's important, though. Let's talk a little bit, Alex. Why don't you talk about some of the misconceptions around people that do home-based birth? You know, maybe talk about some, without naming names, even some of the sorts of profiles of people that you work with.
Sure. Okay. Well, you know, right now, I would say there's some hype that people who are choosing to do this type of birth experience are renegades. In my experience, it's just people who are wanting more of an empowering experience. They want choice. They want to be cared for. You know, Sarah was talking about the 15-minute appointment. That's extended for most OB appointments. People who are educated, professionals. I've had doctors, lawyers, nurses. I had an anesthesiologist. I had an obstetrician who flew in from Japan to give birth here in the States. Teachers, I mean, really everybody, anybody who is truly seeking extraordinary care, who wants somebody who's going to be with them and listen to them and hear their questions and spend the time to talk with them about their fears. It can be anybody, but really people who are choosing to have more an empowered experience.
Now, some of the differences between a home birth and having a birth in the hospital is, like, what are some choices that you necessarily don't have in most hospitals? I mean, create a situation where it's pushed down your throat, or they give you the scenario of, like, this, you know, you're an idiot not to do this. What are those common things women should know about at the hospital?
Yeah. You're most likely not going to be able to walk around, which is not going to be helpful for a laboring woman because you need to move
your
body.
You're on your back in the stirrup things.
What you're
about
on your back.
IV thing.
Oh yeah.
You've got an IV.
Are the IVs necessary?
That was like a big thing for me.
We're animals, right? And if you look at us from that primal mammal level, I mean, does any other animal need an IV to give birth? No. Okay.
Not that I've been there, but I'm sure no.
I mean, from what I've seen, or haven't seen. So, you know, you can't eat or drink during labor. I mean, it's really...
Did you eat or drink during your labor?
You know, the second time happened so fast. I did, because you made me go get coconut water because you thought I was dehydrated. Remember?
Were you laboring at the supermarket?
Yeah, I went to the... Alex was convinced...
Go walk down the aisle. Alex just was go like, up and down the aisle.
She was like, you shouldn't be in labor today. You should be in labor next week. And I was... So I was like, she's like, go to the market and get yourself some coconut water and take a bath. And I was like, okay. So I went to the market. I was in labor. And about 4 hours later, I had a baby.
The way I remember it. As we got a call saying, you had food poisoning.
No, I was feeling like I had the flu.
Right. And I was like, is she in labor? That was the first thought
that
occurred
to me. And how close to the due date was it?
A week.
Okay, so you thought this could be it.
Yeah, especially second baby.
And, you know, she had some of the symptoms, like diarrhea. Well, I don't know if we should say that here, right? She had some symptoms.
I don't think we're shy on this show.
Okay, things were looser. Yeah. nausea, vomiting.
I was clearing out.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Your body was getting ready.
Yeah.
So,
any other things? You know, for instance, why do the hospitals have you just lay in a bed? I mean, it's obvious they need to put you in a bed.
Yeah, what's up with that on your back? Is that because that's how it kind of happened in the first place?
And what are some of the other positions that are good for you to actually be in?
Well, in a hospital environment, you have a nurse who's got 5 patients, and everything happens on the monitor. She can't be watching a woman in labor. So if she's in the bed, she can have a woman who's laboring can have monitors on them, and they can track her progress or her contractions in the baby. Also, when it comes time for delivery, a woman on her back with the table raised and the woman's legs up
wouldn't
in stirrups. Wouldn't
the baby slide back in?
It does often. Oh. And, you know, it can put a lot of compression on the baby in terms of blood flow, but it's convenient for the doctors who just have to reach over and catch a baby. It's not convenient for anybody else. And it's certainly...
Oh, it's for the whole, like, catching of the ball.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh. Well, we have some photos. Sarah, you were so kind enough to share intimate. Some are, you know, part nude, but, you know, you were so... It means a lot, I think, for a lot of people who are watching to see your experience. And you were there. There's both of you in the photos. So we're just going to look at some of these photos. So what's going on here? You're just in a lot of pain, I mean, obviously.
I had just gotten out of the pool, and I am having a serious contraction. And Alex is sitting on my ottoman, and
taking a break.
And her partner Jake, who's also amazing, was holding me, basically, kind of helping to take some of the energy from the contraction. Yeah.
And the soft lighting.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That track lighting.
And this is in your living room, right?
This is in my living room.
Pool, mm-hmm. This portable pool.
Yeah.
Like a kiddie pool.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And you are just bent over in a way different position that we are stereotypically see in the hospital of a woman resting. And is this more comfortable to be kind of crouched forward? Is it more like, it's kind of like you want to be in a fetal, like you want to be...
Well, you want to be in a fetal position, but you can't get there because of your belly. And with both of my sons, it was I labored differently. But you just kind of move around until you get into a position that feels right.
So wait, you can actually get in a position that works for you?
You get in a position that works for you, and you kind of stay there until it doesn't work anymore.
And your lower back hurts a lot, I take it, during?
There's the baby. Right after they handed him to me, yeah.
So as soon as the baby came out of you, what happened next?
So
the baby was just handed to you.
When Reese was born, I was squatting on the floor, and he pushed me into a standing position, and Jake and Alex caught him together, and it was beautiful, because there were these 4 hands that, like, gently guided him out of me. And then Alex just reached him up and put him on my chest, and I said, I want to sit down. And I sat down, and here we are.
So your baby was not taken away from you. It wasn't necessary.
Now, how important are those few seconds after the baby comes out to not be taken to a table or the cord being cut? Like, tell us a little bit about that experience.
Well, as soon as the baby's born, both the mom, the baby, they're having floods of hormones just washing over them. Mm-hmm. It's peak experience for both of them, which is why you see in these videos, as soon as the baby's born, this just, you can't even describe the look these women's faces. And it's also happening to the dad as well, because he is now transported to his own birth experience. Mm-hmm. So just on the hormonal level, the hormones are pumping. I call it fireworks going off in every cell in our bodies.
I was shaking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is an extraordinary moment in our own, like, biological evolution right there, okay? Baby's born, goes on mom, oxygen-rich blood is pumping to the baby. We're talking a serious quantity of blood that is flooding the baby's system, and making sure all the blood vessels are getting erect, which means, like, it's like, it's almost like the expansion of a water balloon. Mm-hmm. Okay? It's an awesome physical experience.
But to be fair, though, you can have this experience in a hospital. I mean, we're not here to suggest that you can't have this sort of, you're not going to, like, you go to a hospital, have a baby, and all of a sudden it's not beautiful. Like, I think we have to be fair.
Sure.
But, and you can ask at a hospital, you can say, I would like my baby to be immediately put on me. Don't go clean it. Don't cut the cord. You can make these requests. I mean, that's part of the education process of what we can and can't ask for. Isn't that true?
Well, you can, but you're not the one in charge in a hospital setting. It's the doctor.
But okay. Can't you say, I do not want this
you
child?
You can, but it doesn't mean it's going to happen. Oh, gotcha. I see it all the time. You know, I also do plenty of hospital births, and, you know, the cord, the placenta is going to pump oxygen-rich blood to that baby for somewhere between 5 and 20 minutes.
Wow.
Right? And, you know, doctors like, oh, stop pulsing, and they cut. You know, it's really not designed to support the choice of a woman. It's designed to support the convenience of the system. And I'm not saying the system is bad. It's just been run a certain way for so long where everybody has their job. Nurses have their job. Doctors have their job. So everybody's waiting to do their job. And when a woman's like, this is how I want it done, it's not necessarily going to happen that way. Mm-hmm. You know?
And so, especially in the moment, too, I'm sure, that when you're in, you know, immense pain, it's emotional, and you wanted to stick to a certain plan, but then they kind of put the pressure on you, perhaps, that,
and you're at their mercy.
Go do it this way.
Right.
Or your baby's not going to be safe. We'd better rush you in for a C-section.
Right.
And they use fear tactics.
Exactly. And if somebody says your baby's life is at risk, what mother is going to say, no, my agenda's more important? You know, it just doesn't work that way.
Now, you have an interesting story that you shared with us before the show that... You have, how old's your baby?
She's 15 months old.
15, congratulations.
Thank you.
But you didn't have your baby at home.
I didn't. Tell us
about what happened.
Yeah, what happened?
Well, I actually had fibroids in my uterus, which as soon as I found out I was pregnant, I found out I had fibroids, and they were growing along with the pregnancy. And so I always knew, I mean, really every labor is a trial of labor. Mm-hmm. So there was always that possibility that I wasn't going to end up delivering her at home. And what ended up happening in my circumstance is that my daughter Juno got herself into a position and never moved really out of that position once she went head down because the fibroids were kind of interfering with her shifting because they were large. I had a 14-centimeter one and a 4-centimeter one. So she was kind of wedged. Mm. And then during the labor process, my uterus just wasn't really functioning the way it could have been. And so after 2 days of labor.
At home.
Oh.
I realized it was time to kind of throw in the towel and get myself to a hospital.
So you can start at home, and if need be, you can still go to the hospital.
Absolutely.
And so how was your experience at the hospital?
Well, I had brought my midwife and my doula with me. And, you know, if I had one piece of advice to give any woman who's still choosing to have a hospital birth, absolutely have a doula with you. They say having another womb in the room cuts down on C-section rates 50%.
Oh, wow.
So, another womb in the room.
That's right. Okay, so I brought my doula. I had brought my midwife. I had to have some refreshed midwives come with me. But, you know, when typically what happens is if you are working with a midwife and you end up transporting, the midwife comes with you or somebody from her team will come. That's certainly how we operate at the sanctuary. But I had an epidural, and I had Pitocin, and I really needed those drugs to work in this situation because my body was tired. 2 days of dysfunctional labor was just, I needed some help, and that's when going to the hospital is great. You have those options there for you when you need them, and every woman doesn't need them, obviously, you know?
But does it give you credibility more when you're talking to somebody as a midwife to share your personal experience so they know you're not pushing your own agenda onto somebody because you're, at the end of the day, you're making the best choice for you and the baby?
Right, and it's always that way, you know? We have the agenda for a healthy mom and a healthy baby, and after 2 days of labor, I knew that that wasn't going to be possible for me. And I would never want to put my client in a situation where I was risking the well-being of either one of them.
And it sounds like it's literally about listening to what those needs are. So it's not a matter of judgment. It's not a matter of saying, well, you shouldn't have the drugs or anything like that. It's literally just listening and appreciating what the woman needs in that moment.
And I don't think anybody should be judged if they choose a hospital birth or a home birth. I'm seeing, we see a lot of people, you know, judge people for having an epidural or have, it's like a new wave of judgment, and no one should be judged. I mean, that's my personal opinion. No one should be judged.
Absolutely.
At the end of the day, the choice you make is the best choice you make as a mother.
Right, and you know, I think what's most important is that people are informed.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And that's what the point of today's show was, about education. Really quickly, can we go through some common misperceptions of home birth? So people, we hear a lot like, well, if the baby's head gets stuck, what are you going to do? You can't, you know, you're stuck. You can't go to an ambulance. The hospital's too far away. Mm-hmm. What's the common answer you give to someone who asks that?
Well, the truth about birth is either it's going to work or it doesn't. Okay? And, you know, babies who don't come out, we go to the hospital. Now, like the head getting stuck, or really, I think what you're talking about maybe is the shoulders getting stuck.
Yeah, I mean, like you're in a situation, what about that situation where you have no time? Or what is the protocol?
Well, the thing is, there's so many different techniques and maneuvers that we can do and that we're trained to do. Remember, we're licensed by the medical board, so.
That's important.
Yes.
You have to know what to do in the event of. And, you know, if people are considering doing a home birth, when they're interviewing midwives, they should really find out what kind of skills, trainings, licensure, because certain states, it's still illegal to practice midwifery.
So
really? Illegal, midwifery. Midwifery. So basically, you know, you want to really find out who your care provider is going to be. Same thing if you're choosing an obstetrician. You want to make sure your doctor is recommended.
Right, and so you want to ask friends.
Yeah, you want to find out what that doctor's C-section rate is and, you know, like their episiotomy rate.
And that is something you midwives do as well. That's another common myth. What if I tear? What, you know, there's no medical care. But you guys, but midwives, you're trained to be able to sew and what have you. You tore?
I tore with my first son, and they stitched me up at home.
And no
just
local?
Fine.
Did you have a local?
I had a local.
So you're able to administer, that's another common myth.
Right.
Oh, there's no drugs at all, so they're stitching me, that's painful. Mm-hmm. So you administer local.
Well, we don't do drugs during labor.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We do something called an aquadural.
Right.
What up with that?
What is that?
Well, basically, you know, what you saw with Sarah laboring is she was in a water birth tub.
Oh, okay. That's where that tub comes in.
Yeah. It's, you know, the water drug.
And what does the water do? Why?
Yeah.
Because, like, I know that if I'm in a bath for too long, I get annoyed. Like, what is the...
And does everyone want to be in the tub? Do they... Do some people, like, use a ball and...
And it doesn't look so pretty at the end. I mean... It's like a bloodbath. Sorry.
Well, you know... Some people like the tub. Some people start off in the tub.
Right.
Sarah started.
I go into the tub. I like the tub. It's warm.
I like the tub.
I like the tub.
Does it
I like the shower.
Does it make the contractions feel less intense?
It for me, whenever I don't feel good, in general, I go in the water. Mm-hmm. But when I was in labor, it definitely, it's like an enveloping heating pad, kind of, which is nice. And then with my second son, I was able to lie in that pool, and I was having some back contractions, and so Jake was putting her hands underneath me, and I was kind of floating, and the weightlessness was really helping to kind of ease the pain of the contractions so that I was able to breathe through them and not, I mean, I really never lost myself to any of the contractions.
Mm-hmm. And what about the baby, you know, especially with the tub? You know, I've seen a lot of videos where the baby is coming out into the water. Mm-hmm. Is that better for the baby? Is it more of a seamless transition, so to speak, because they're going from the womb into water?
Absolutely. I mean, for one, women tend to be more relaxed in the water. Mm-hmm. So when the mother's relaxed, the baby's relaxed. You know, they're really very connected. Once the baby's born, it's gentle, it's gradual. You see a woman pick her own baby up when she's ready, or the midwife will hand the baby to her. You know, it's just so much softer and slower. Plus, the fluid often will wash off anything from the birth.
Oh, that yucky kind of look when it comes out.
Yeah, I mean,
that's actually,
And then women tend to tear less when they give birth in water.
Oh, because they're all, okay.
Oh, tear less.
The tissue stretches.
Who is it, Kourtney Kardashian? Who just had the
baby? So, yeah.
She, like, put her hands down and, like, pulled it out, essentially. Did you see that?
I saw it.
I was curious if she had an epidural, if that's why she was able to.
I think.
Did you watch?
No expert. I think she had an epidural.
Yeah, because she was like,
yeah.
she was.
She was, that was like, there was soft music playing. Mm-hmm.
But that's another thing. That's another bit of advice.
Exactly.
If you're going to have a hospital
birth, hospital,
lighting is
ever,
important. Yeah. Music is important.
The temperature in the room.
These are things you can ask for, mm-hmm. right?
Yep. You can ask for whatever you'd like. And, you know, it just really depends.
Some will deliver, some won't.
You know, you have to understand that the doctor shows up when the baby's head is like this big on the perineum. So it's not like, you know, it really depends on what nurse is there. And, you know, as a woman in labor in the hospital, you don't know the people taking care of you.
Mm-hmm. What about people who, the skeptics, who say this is irresponsible, that if something, the baby comes out, there's something wrong with the baby, you don't have a medical team there
right.
to take care of it. What do you say to people when they say that?
I say a lot. First of all, we are a medical team, okay? Mm-hmm. And right. we can see issues with mom and baby. So okay. we can deal. They're both our client. We don't call them patients because they're not sick. So, you know, I'm trained to deal with complications for the mom or for the baby. Okay? It just tends to be in a much softer environment. Now, you know, just being in the hospital and dealing with a baby with complications, you know, babies are whisked away. They're handled very differently. They're not really treated with the respect of this baby has just been born into the world.
They're a little rougher.
Extremely, you know, and there's no connection. Whereas I can deal with almost any complication dealing with that baby right in the mother's arms. So there's this connection. I never have to separate the mom and the baby. I can resuscitate a baby. It's the same thing they would do in the hospital. But I'm going to do it right there with the baby in the mother's arms where the baby's getting oxygen-rich blood. They're going to recover much quicker. Right here, hearing their mother's voice, smelling their mother, you know, or the father touching them, you know, it becomes much more about the connection and the gentleness, and then you don't deal with these major complications. Mm-hmm. Also, with women who are in the hospital who have drugs, you're going to deal with a lot more complications.
Right.
There was recently, the largest study was published in the British Medical Journal that looked at 5,000 births in the home and 5,000 births in the hospital. And they looked at what was the difference between these births, what was the difference in neonatal mortality or maternal mortality, and there was no difference. The only difference was a fewer amount of interventions in the home birth setting, mm-hmm. fewer C-sections, and much more enjoyment of the experience.
I mean, it doesn't look like it's that much. I mean, it doesn't look like it's that much fun. I mean, it looks like it's really painful. I mean, why should somebody with the technology we have, I'm playing devil's advocate here, we have the technology to have an epidural so we don't have to experience this pain. Why would somebody want to go through this?
I want to know from Sarah.
I was thinking the same thing.
Sarah.
So as I gave birth the
nuts?
Second time, I looked at you and said, but you had the drugs. you know what? It is so empowering. Mm-hmm. But I think that for most women, no matter how they deliver their baby, being a mother is an empowering experience. Mm-hmm. But I, you know, for me, being able to go through what I went through and to be able to experience my body doing what it was designed to do, and really for me as a challenge to allow myself to surrender to that and just allow my child to be born in the most natural way possible, it is the most powerful experience I think that I will ever
have. So you're saying the pain
is
worth it?
It's not painful. I mean, it is painful, but you're going through something, you're on a journey, it's worth it, but it doesn't occur like this painful thing that I need to have taken away. It's part of the experience.
Yeah. Sounds like a lot of it is very psychological.
It is.
Psychological and emotional.
I mean, I've had some friends tell me it was like the worst pain they've ever experienced, and it's hard to be like, oh, I can't wait to do it at all.
Yeah, I can't wait to do it.
I mean, these are people in the hospital with an epidural.
I'm more afraid of going and getting my wisdom teeth pulled than I would be of having another natural childbirth at home.
And I've had my wisdom teeth pulled. All four of them were impacted, and it was the worst pain I've ever been through in my life.
So
that's probably my comparison.
Neither.
And you didn't get a baby out of it either.
Exactly.
You know,
I didn't get anything out of it.
There is a prize. It's like a prize in the Cracker Jack. I mean, there's a big prize at the end here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, when my son Reese was being born, I kind of had a meltdown, and then Alex had a very straight conversation with me and basically was like, you know, 3 pushes and you're done. It's going to hurt, but you'll be done. And when I actually finally gave in and was pushing him out, I don't want to say that it was pleasurable, But I was so aware of the sensation and of my baby coming down and moving through my body. And as you remember, I was so aware of where he was mm-hmm. when they were checking his heartbeat. I was like, it's right there. It was just such a deep connection with my child, and the experience of feeling him going from here to here and, you know, yeah. moving through, there is an element of pleasure involved.
But what if you need an emergency C-section? And they call it an emergency C-section for a reason.
Absolutely.
I'm you know, I think it's fair to ask these questions because sure. people who are watching right. are they're going to all the questions like the what ifs.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, so what is the situation? You know in advance, and how do you ever really know an emergency is happening when they call it an emergency?
Well, here's the deal, okay? We're listening. It's not like we're just praying and hoping everything goes great.
Right.
You know, we're using an ultrasound device that we can use in the water that doesn't interrupt the woman's experience, where we can assess the well-being of baby. And studies have shown that the Doppler, which is what we use, has better outcomes, better fetal outcomes than using the constant monitor.
Okay.
Wow.
So we're paying attention to this baby, and things don't go from great, great, great to, you know, shitstorm in a moment.
Right.
That happens way more in a hospital when you're using drugs that are going to affect the mother's blood pressure, that can depress the baby. You know, when you're dealing with a healthy woman, remember, we started this saying we deal with a low-risk pregnancy.
Low risk.
Healthy women. And when they take care of themselves throughout their pregnancy, what's, you know, that the chance that they're going to actually need to go in and have drugs or have a C-section is much less than if they, you know, aren't taking such
good care. But they're laboring really long.
So, you know, we're patient. We don't have a golf game to get to, you know. we are here watching and listening and paying attention to the mom. And, you know, we are assessing well-being. And when things start going outside of the range of normal, that's when we transport. It's when you use drugs that things can really go wrong.
Well, Amanda has a little bit of a...
A what?
A little bit of a secret she's been holding back on us this whole time.
You, I don't know what you're talking about.
You were born not in a hospital.
No, I was not,
and
actually.
We saved it to the end. See? Trying to make you think we're both, like, you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, I can't speak directly to the experience because, well, I don't remember it, but... I do have, you know, a lot of stories from my mom, and I was actually born, and I grew up in a very small town of 1,500 people, and everyone in my generation and a few years before and after were born down the street at this local doctor's office. It was an old house that was converted into, you know, an office downstairs and two birthing rooms upstairs. Mm-hmm. And yeah, my mother just decided right out of the gate that she did not want to have her baby at a hospital. And I guess that she went into labor in the afternoon. She called my grandmother, and they went straight to the doctor's office. And a few hours later, I was born. And, you know, it was a lot like what we've watched on these videos where the lighting was soft, apparently. My mom was in just an old bed, and she got up every once in a while. And, you know, she was able to use a mirror to look and see where I was and feel my head. And the whole experience, apparently, the way she talks about it is so loving. And, you know, to your point, Sarah, the same thing where it was just this connection, this really, really deep connection. And maybe in my heart and my soul, I feel that with my mom because the beauty of it, you know, really translates to me. And she speaks so highly of it, and that when I came out of her body, they immediately put me on her. And I opened my eyes and I looked at her and I didn't cry. Apparently, I mean, this might be just a tall tale in my family, but apparently I didn't cry. I just opened my eyes and I stretched and I smiled and I looked at my mom, and she said, we just connected then and there on her body. And she went, oh my goodness, there's a human being on me.
It is the most spectacular moment in a woman's life,
yeah.
I think.
Mm-hmm.
We thought we would give her a call.
You want to call my mom?
Yeah, we want to call. But first, maybe should we see some photos of the sanctuary?
Yeah, let's look at some photos of the
sanctuary
beforehand.
Well, we get her mom on the phone, because we definitely want to chat with her. We're going to see some photos of the sanctuary where Alex practices the home. Well, it's where if you don't want to have it at home, you can have it at the center. And here are some of the photos.
Oh, wow. Do you want to talk about these?
Yeah, Alex.
Okay, well, right here we have the birth tub. Certainly there won't be candles burning when you're in labor, but if somebody wanted to come in labor here in this tub, it's big enough for the mom, for the dad, for the partner, for the younger kids, if they want to join in the water.
That's a beautiful tub. Look at how gorgeous.
Oh, look at that.
That is not like, if you think like home center, that would be scary. Look, that is unbelievable. Look at the design.
It's beautiful.
And the warm lighting really does make a difference.
Can you imagine your whole family there hanging with you?
Yeah.
Just having this, play the music you want. And this is located in Los Angeles.
That's right. The Sanctuary Birth and Family Wellness Center is on Venice Boulevard in Mar Vista area. Mm-hmm. And we do all different types of care. We also do preconception work. We do postpartum, childbirth education.
Yeah.
We do medical hypnosis and chiropractic, cranial acupuncture. Really full service.
So you can have that while you're laboring at the sanctuary.
Yeah,
your phone's probably ringing off the hook. Baby boom going on out there.
We are definitely starting to get really busy. It's the only birth center on the west side.
Wow.
There we go. Oh, is that mom?
I think that's mom.
Mom's calling in. Answer. Mom?
Hello.
Hi, mom.
Good afternoon, ladies.
Thank you for joining us. We were just chatting about your birth.
So everyone, this is my mother, Cheryl Coulong. I know that we've brought up her name on this weekend shows. Well, now you finally get to hear from her.
Well, you had a pretty amazing experience. Well, you had two different kinds of experiences, right?
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about your experience having it? Was it the build? Was it a home or?
Actually, do we have the picture that we can pull up of the doctor's office? Might be able
to see
just that.
A little New England building.
There it is.
Building.
Aww.
So, okay, everybody, here on screen is a picture of Dr. Smith's office on Main Street in Strong, Maine, where I was born. And I believe, Mom, wasn't it the upstairs window on the right or on the left? On the left.
On
that corner window, that was the room I was born in. So this
and
is just an
well
old house.
And in my home, you can see it's like four houses down from where I live. And I still go by the building and quite often look up there and remember the experience very fondly.
Mm. Go ahead and tell them the story, Mom. I kind of gave them a little bit about what you've told me.
Oh, no, you put my picture on. That's terrible. Yes. Yeah, well, it was. It was a very good experience. And talking of pain. Yeah, Dave, they can hear us. Yeah, you can feel it is painful, but it's an experience. And I had the experience of being able to have Amanda in a very loving, supporting, nurturing environment that was, you know, her and I were the focus. Whereas my son, 6 years later, I ended up having in a hospital, and it was totally opposite.
Why was it so different? Besides the obvious.
I was listening earlier. Yeah, the doctors do have their job to do. The nurses have their job to do. And you can have a birth plan. In the end, it's going to be according to what they want to do. You know, it was treated like a medical procedure, not a happening. And I had quite a bit of depression, not postpartum depression, but depression over the experience in the hospital. After having my son, it was just tragic. Everything was taken out of my control, and the connection with the event wasn't there like it was at Dr. Smith's, having her in that home setting. Everything was geared to her and myself, whereas in the hospital, it was like, okay, let's get this done and over with. Mm-hmm. But, yes, I would have had my son at home if I could have at that point, but I didn't know that was an option. My doctor had left.
Yeah, Dr. Smith was gone by then, so Mom had to go to the hospital.
And most of the kids in your town were born
here.
Yeah,
I mean, there was an entire generation of us, you know, for like, I would even say a 10-year period. I mean, my mom could speak to that, but everyone in my class, a few years before me, a few years after me, we were all born in that house.
And so...
all of us.
Since the beginning of time.
And there weren't complications. I mean, no one ever talked about, oh, well, you should, you know, you're missing a finger because you were born at Dr. Smith's office. Everyone was fine.
Yes,
but I mean, the experience
does arise. You've got people there that see mm-hmm. what's going on, and if it's going in a bad direction, yeah, you can get to a hospital. My first reaction when I went to Dr. Smith and he offered me the option of having my baby there, my first thought was, oh my goodness, what if something happens, right. You know? And he's like, look, I'm a doctor. We can get you to a hospital. You know, babies have been born at home for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. My mother was born at home.
Wasn't Nana put in a drawer after she was born, Mom?
No, she was too fat. She was 10 pounds.
10 pounds and born at home. Very important.
God bless her.
Very important piece of information.
The fifth child, and my mother-in-law helped deliver her own sister at home.
Uh-huh.
You know, so this idea of everyone having to go to a hospital to have a baby, you know, in the big scope of things is relatively new.
Did I really not cry?
You didn't cry. You didn't. It was amazing. They had the pulled the shades and had it very quiet, turned off the fan, and it was just beautiful. You were put right on me, and very gently the afterbirth was delivered, and everyone disappeared and left us alone. It was fabulous. And this, in the hospital, when your brother was born, he was crying the minute his head came out. They had bright lights on him, whisked him off.
No one looks good in bright lights. Nobody.
No, especially at that moment in time.
But this for me, I mean, I think what I love about this is I get to share this story and this experience with my mom now. Mm-hmm. She has relayed this story to me throughout my life, whenever I'm upset, whenever I'm down, whenever I feel lost or alone, my mother talks about our connection. Mm. And she relays that story to me. Mm. And it makes me feel that. And even though she's 3,000 miles away from me, I have that with her right now. And that's beautiful to me. And I don't know if everyone has that.
Well, you know.
Well, I think that the difference in the birth, you know, it was, there was pain, but it was all, it was something going on. It wasn't a medical procedure. Whereas in the hospital, you know, all draped and everything.
It seems like it'd feel worse because you're like, I should be in more pain. I'm at a hospital.
Yeah. Oh, you
tighten up.
Yeah,
Well, I'm glad that you joined us because I think a lot of people think this is a new age thing or this is
right.
some trend,
no, it is.
But it's not. It's been going on forever, and
right.
you're living proof that you're fine.
Yeah. Well, some in the studio would argue that I'm
that.
A little bit whoo-hoo, but it's okay.
Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate you taking the time and sharing your lovely story.
Well,
I love you, Mom.
Me. Yeah, I love you too.
Bye.
Goodbye.
You know, what was interesting about the way your mom was describing it, it's really, that's the nature of the event itself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what she experienced with you, what you experienced with her is the same today.
Right.
It was the same 5,000 years ago, you know, that that connection that, you know, we were talking about the fireworks that go off in everyone's cells, that bonded you.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
you
I
know?
Think just to kind of recap, I think at the end of the day, no one judges anyone for their decisions.
Right.
It's all about choice. You just have to do your homework and know that if you want this type of experience, but you still want to be in a hospital, just know that there's certain things you can ask for.
And bring another womb into the room.
Bring another womb into the room. Do your research. There are a lot of facilities now that may be more of a hybrid situation where you have like a home birth situation, but there's medical care right there.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, at the end of the day, it's all about choice.
Mm-hmm. And you can even bring your baby with you home, like because I was born in a birthing center, you could even bring your baby home the same day.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the same day, rather than sitting in a hospital overnight.
Yeah, oh, you're not sick. You just gave birth.
Oh,
you're not sick, you just gave
birth.
I like that.
We got a lot of good lines out of today. Well, we want to thank both of you for taking such time out of your busy schedules. I know you're both moms. And
you have babies to get back to.
You have babies to get back to. And thank you for sharing so much of your, you know, being so candid and honest. I think you probably helped a lot of people who are watching today make a more informed choice. And if you have any further questions for Alex, you can email us at info@healthybitchdaily.com. Yes, I said bitch. info@healthybitchdaily.com, and we will be sure to get your questions answered. Is that okay that I just offered that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you, and join us next week for This Week in Health and Wellness. And next week, we're going to be cooking up some vegan dishes.
Mm.
Thank you for joining us.